All right, welcome back to our Introduction to Machine Learning for Material Science. This is section one. We'll be talking through a little bit about the data and how do we, you know, get data into a format that we can actually use for machine learning. As a few reminders before we dive in, for the Jupyter notebook that we have, you will need to run all of the cells as we're going along. So if you're just kind of picking up in this section, make sure you have already run these introduction cells. This kind of sets up things and makes sure everything's ready to go for the cells we'll be running later. So to check that, you can look at the number on the left side here. All of these, or you should look at the square brackets on the left side here. All of them should have a number inside of them. If they do, that means they've been ran and you should be good to go. So if we scroll down to the outline section or the table of contents here, we can jump right down to the section one on data just by clicking right here. So the data set that we'll be working with is a band gap data set. It's not important that you know a huge amount about the kind of background there, but we do have a section here, if you scroll up a little bit, that gives you some of the background on, you know, why is this interesting and why might we want to make some predictions in this area. To give you the super short version, you know, band gaps, one way that they're really interesting is that we can use them to design solar materials. So if we had a machine learning model that could predict band gaps in new materials, you know, potentially we could discover new materials, we could make things more efficient or more cheap, and hopefully, you know, just make solar materials even better than they already are. So I'll leave that for your own interest if you want to read through in a little more detail, but we'll start looking in at, you know, what are we actually going to do here. So the first thing we're going to do is just read in the data set and look at, you know, what is material science data look like. And in this case, we have a few columns that are really interesting here. The first one is going to be this chemical formula column, which I'm highlighting here in the middle. And this just tells us, you know, what elements are present in the materials that we're looking at. What do we have here? And then the other one is just, you know, what is the property we're trying to predict? So we have the band gap values here in a column. And the key thing to understand is that, you know, each row of here is one material. And then we have a measurement about, you know, what is that material's band gap. The couple other columns on the right here are a little bit less important. But the one that I'll call attention to is this reliability column, which we'll touch on in a second in a little more detail. And this is giving us some information about how reliable is the experiment that was done to find this data. And we'll look through that again in a few seconds here. But this is what yours should look like. And if we scroll down to the bottom, we can actually see, you know, how many data points we have overall. If I get all the way to the bottom here, looks like we have 1,447 rows and six columns. So that means we have 1,447 measurements of band gaps for various materials. So if we go down to the next section here, so that, you know, has basically imported the data. We have it available to us. And the first thing that we want to do is do some data cleaning. And when we talk about cleaning, what we mean is that we need the data in a format that is, you know, easy for the machine learning model to understand. And one thing that you might have noticed in the previous data, inspection of the data set, is it looks like we have a lot of duplicates. So if I look at the chemical formula here, I actually have you know, a number of the same composition here. And this is the same if I scroll down throughout the data set. It looks like there's duplicates here, there's duplicates here. And this might be an issue because if we're trying to, you know, train a model that's going to make predictions, if it has a bunch of different measurements for the same formula, it might start getting a little confused. And that'll be basically extra noise we're putting into the data, or into the model, I should say. So the first thing we're going to try to do is get rid of those duplicates. So one way we can do that, again, is using this reliability column, which tells us, you know, which of these are more trustworthy measurements than others. So if something has a reliability of one in this case, we're going to say that's more trustworthy. And if it has a reliability of two or any other number, it's less reliable. So we're just going to filter out and say, you know, let's keep only the ones that have reliability of one in them. So basically, I've gotten rid of all those other ones. You can see all these now have one that are left. And you can see in the index here, the ones that were removed. So you can see this skips around, and the missing numbers are the ones we just got rid of. However, it looks like we didn't actually get to where we wanted to be. We wanted to be where we have, you know, a single formula for each measurement we have. So we might have to come up with another strategy for how we can get to, you know, one measurement for each formula. And the way that we're going to do that is we're just going to say, you know, if we have these two measurements and they're equally reliable, we don't have a way to distinguish between them, why don't we just average across them? So we're going to use the average value between our different measurements and use that as our value that we're going to assign for each composition. So we can do that in the next couple cells here. If I just keep going down, We will get a little warning here. This has to do with some versioning issues here, but it should still execute fine. As long as you, again, have this number here, it should be okay. And now we can see the output. And now we are at, I think, where we want to be, where we have a single formula and a single value for each formula. And what's interesting and what is worth kind of keeping track of is, you know, how many data points do we have now? Potentially we filtered out a large number of points, and it looks like we did. So previously we had, you know, 1400 or so, and now we're down to, you know, a little less than 500 data points. So this is something that, you know, can come up often where it looks like, you know, we had a lot of data, but potentially a lot of that data wasn't actually useful to us. So when we got down to our cleaned data set, now we're down to, you know, 467 data points. And that's just something to keep in mind. Because, you know, one of the key things about machine learning is the more data you have, the better. But at the same time, you know, the more clean, good data you have also, you know, the better. So it's not necessarily always good to add in more and more data if you're just adding in more and more noise to your model. So hopefully by cleaning this down to 467 points, we have better data to feed in for our model going forward. And the last thing we're going to do here is we're just going to inspect the data a little bit. So we're going to look through, you know, what is the data we have? And the two ways we're going to do that first is we're just going to say, start looking through the band gap data. And we're going to say, you know, what is the range of band gap data we have? So we can print out a little bit of description here. And what this is telling us is what are the values of band gaps that we have? What's the max? What's the minimum? So it looks like the minimum here is 0.009. So it's very, very low. And then the max is 13, which is very high as far as band gaps are concerned. But that gives us an idea of what is the range of values that are interesting and relevant to us. So for example, if our model gave us a prediction and said, you know, I think this band gap is 100, that might start to, you know, raise some eyebrows because we only gave it data up to 13. You know, why would it be predicting 100? We also might also ask the question, you know, is 100 a relevant value for a band gap? Does that make any sense? What if it gave us a negative value for a band gap? Stuff like that. So because the values we have are all positive, they're all, you know, in the scale of 0 to 10 or so, those would be reasonable predictions. Anything outside of that, we should really, you know, that would raise alarm bells. So that's one way you can, you know, look at your data set and hopefully learn, you know, what is things to be paying attention to. The other thing we're going to do here in the next section, excuse me, is we're going to look through another way of visualizing that, which is with this histogram. So this tells us how the values are actually distributed across this range. So we said we can go from 0 to, you know, 12 or 13. And what we can see is that, you know, many more of these values are down around 0, 1, 2, 3 kind of region on the left side of this histogram here, whereas we have very few data points up on the higher end. This is something also just to kind of keep in mind as we're training. If we're making predictions out here, we definitely have less training data in that area. So that's something that we should be aware of. And then I think the last thing we're going to do here is we're going to look through. So I'm running all three of these cells here, which do a little bit of filtering and sorting on the data set and allow us again to visualize it just a little differently. We can sort by the elements that are in the data set. So here we can see in the column, this column in the middle, here's all the element names that are in the data set. And then the count on the right side is how frequently they're in the data set. So what we see is we have a ton of oxygen. We have 240 instances of a composition with oxygen in it in the data set. And again, remember our data set is about 400, 500 large. So about half of the values we have oxygen, or half of the compositions we have oxygen in them. So maybe that's something to keep in mind. Whereas if I scroll down here to the bottom, we have some elements where we only have 1, 2, 3 values in there. So the, you know, initial thing we might think is that, you know, if we're making predictions, perhaps making predictions of things that contain oxygen would be much more relevant to the training data we have, whereas making predictions of a bunch of, you know, things with yttrium and then, for example, where we only have 3 training points, that might be a bit more difficult. So these are, again, the types of things in the analysis we can do before we even dive into machine learning to set up the framework of, you know, here's the data we have, here's the types of predictions we might be able to make later. So finally, I think the last cells here just do an output. So this just outputs the clean data set here. I think by default, this already exists and is included. So you'll see it says, gives you this note, this exists, not created in the new file. But if you were running this and you didn't have it, this would give you this cleaned version of the data set. So it's bandgap data version 3. So that gets us through the data section. So I'll leave it there and we'll jump in next time for the feature generation. This is where we take the compositions and actually get them into a form that we can use as input for the machine learning model.